Humans have always been driven towards building bigger, grander, taller, and more massive things. You can see this everywhere you look, from the pyramids in Egypt to the Burj Khalifa in the United Arab Emirates. These enormous structures are testaments not only to the ambition of mankind, but to their amazing engineering abilities. The only issue is that the bigger, taller, or wider you build something, the more prone to accidents the entire project becomes, especially as the structure ages and becomes worn by the elements. What would it look like if a part of the Burj Khalifa randomly gave way? How many lives would be lost? What is the lifespan of something like the Golden Gate Bridge, which is nearly 100 years old? There are even examples of how human ambition proved to be too great. Enormous buildings or even entire cities have sat vacant for years. When structures such as these fail or are abandoned, the cost is enormous, both financially and in terms of lives lost. From massive engineering miscalculations to brand new buildings tipping over, here are 5 construction mistakes that cost millions. Interstate 35 in Minneapolis, Minnesota is a very busy thoroughfare. One section of the highway was built over the Mississippi River at the St. Anthony Falls. This bridge opened in 1967 and at its busiest time carried 140,000 vehicles per day. In terms of size, it was rather large, measuring 1,907 feet across and clearing the river below by 81 feet. Over the years, though, the tens of millions of cars that used it each year started taking its toll. On August 1st, 2007, at 6:05 p.m., it was rush hour on the bridge and traffic was moving slowly. Suddenly, the central span of the bridge gave way, followed shortly after by the adjoining spans. Both the structure and the deck of the central span fell 81 feet into the river below. The northern sections fell into a rail yard, landing on 3 freight cars. In total, 111 vehicles were involved. Although only a few of the vehicles were actually submerged, a total of 13 people lost their lives as a result of the collapse. A subsequent investigation was conducted by investigators from the Minneapolis DOT and the National Transportation Safety Board. The FBI even sent a team of investigators to give assistance to local authorities. After months of investigations and recovery, the NTSB announced that the bridge's design specified steel gusset plates that were undersized and unable to support the intended load of the bridge. Over the years, that load had increased and caused a gradual degradation of the plates. Eventually, they gave out under the weight, resulting in a total collapse. Between construction of the new bridge and the settlements from the ensuing lawsuits, the overall cost was around $286 million. New York City is full of tall buildings and skyscrapers. One of these buildings, the Citicorp Tower, has a particularly unique story. Sitting at 59 stories, it held the title for the 7th tallest building in the world when it was finished in 1977. It wasn't hard to identify in the city thanks to its 45-degree angled top. However, it's the base of the building that is the most unique because the bottom 9 stories of the building are stilts. It was built in this way to accommodate St. Peter's Lutheran Church, which occupies one corner of the building's site at 53rd Street and Lexington Avenue. It was a condition of the building's construction that the corner not be touched. So, the stilts were the answer to this condition. However, this made for a big problem. Even though certain features were built into the building's design to make it sturdy, it was in fact very light. In 1978, an undergraduate architecture student contacted the designer with a bold claim about the building. It could blow over in the wind. As she was studying the building and its unique stilt design, she found that it was particularly vulnerable to quartering winds. Normally, these are the strongest parts of the building, but because of the stilts, it turns out that the corners were the weakest part of the Citicorp Tower. The designer checked the figures and found that the student was correct. A storm with significant winds would be able to blow the building over if the winds hit it from the corners. As a matter of fact, the math ended up working out like this. For every year the building stood, there was a 1 in 16 chance that it would collapse. Work was done in secret and very quickly to make the building secure. When workers were gone at night, the construction crews would come into work. News of this story didn't break until 1995. Although the cost of reinforcing construction was in the millions, the cost of a collapse could have been in the hundreds of millions. For as big as the country of China is, there are instances where new development is plagued by shoddy work. On top of that, there is very little oversight when it comes to quality and safety. These elements are the perfect storm for an engineering disaster. Well, on June 27th, 2009, that's exactly what happened in a suburban area of Hong Kong. Construction crews had been building a 13-story residential building. It was one of dozens in that area of the city. Sometime around 6 a.m., the building gave way and fell on its side, staying nearly completely intact on its trip down. One worker lost their life in the incident. The cause of this failure can be attributed to many factors, but the most prominent is the ground on which the building was built. Prior to the collapse, excavation occurred on one side of the building. This, along with other factors, caused the soft clay to weaken and allowed for the pile foundation to slide, ultimately resulting in the collapse. The Chinese government has never been very forthcoming with information concerning its failures. But there is no denying that this disaster was a direct result of the very lax standards by which the Chinese government operates. As is typical in many other parts of the country, the construction was done very quickly using materials that were subpar at best. The population of the country is booming, and expansion has been very rapid. While this method of fast construction is efficient, it doesn't always make the cut as far as safety is concerned. Standing at 62 stories tall on Clarendon Street in Boston, Massachusetts, is the John Hancock Tower. Designed by Henry Cobb, it was completed in 1976. It was the tallest building in all of New England. From the onset, it was obvious that it would be an amazing structure, showcasing beauty through its minimalist appearance. A simple parallelogram design adorned with large panes of glass really brought a modernist flair to the city. Another thing that was evident from the onset was that there were some big engineering flaws, especially with the windows. The building was covered in over 10,000 window panes that were 4 by 11 feet and 500 pounds each. In times when wind would blow over 45 miles per hour, the panes would become detached and crash onto the sidewalk hundreds of feet below. When winds picked up, police would have to close off the surrounding streets in order to protect vehicles and pedestrians. It was found that, much like the Citicorp Tower, this building was very light and moved in the wind. Not only would it sway, but it would also twist. To add to everything else, there were thermal stresses that caused the air between the inner and outer glass to expand and contract, stressing the bonding between them. There was a time that so many panes fell and were patched with plywood, the building was nicknamed Plywood Palace or Plywood Ranch. Not only were all of the panes of glass replaced, two 300-ton weights were installed at opposite ends of the building, stabilizing it during high winds. The total cost was around $10 million. However, the potential disaster was not known until the construction was nearly complete. Studies showed that the entire building could have blown over if it weren't for the added weights and structural reinforcements. Once again, we find ourselves in China, where rapid population growth required a lot of new construction. In 2005, in the city of Dongguan, the South China Mall was built. In terms of total area, it was the second largest mall in the world, next to the Dubai Mall. But in terms of gross leasable area, it was the largest. Builders of this mall forgot the golden rule that even we regular people know about. Location, location, location. The South China Mall was built to be more of an affluent place to shop. The problem is that the city of Dongguan is mostly farmland, and the vast majority of the residents there are lower-income laborers who did not respond at all to the attractions that the mall had to offer. Now, because of the low interest, over 95% of the stores are vacant. The only places that are occupied are near the entrances, where most of them are Western fast food chains. There's even one area of the mall where four full floors are empty. Once again, we see an overly ambitious task that was not properly thought out by the owner. Grandeur and flair won out over practicality, and now, the financial price is being paid. Since the opening, it is estimated that the mall has lost well over $1 billion in utilities and rent. We are capable of building some amazing structures, but whether through miscalculation or not keeping a proper attention to detail, we are also capable of some very costly mistakes. Hopefully, as we strive to build bigger and taller, we keep our ambitious nature in check and focus more on the safety and practicality of the projects. If you enjoyed this video, then be sure to click the link on screen to check out cruise ship accidents that cost millions. Trust me, you won't want to miss it. As always, thanks for watching, and be sure to tune in next time.